want to talk about a band that really represents America's youth culture. It's not, you know, it's not the Go-Go's. It's like people like Wino who have nothing to lose and who have just no need to lie. The guy's got no bullshit. He just says it. If you don't like it, there's the door. You can either walk, or if he gets up, you can run.
The following interviews portray the opinions of Wooten's students as well as faculty.
Let's put it this way. I'd rather do grocery shopping for my mother than watch that concert, okay?
Why did you not like it?
Because the music's just too, like, out of it. You gotta be a big freak to watch that concert.
Okay, it seems that the general opinion is that you all enjoy the concert. I'd like to know why.
Hey, it was jamming, you
Hello.
Know? It was just like a regular
How
concert.
Are you?
Listen, good music. It was our type of music. It wasn't old Fergie music or disco or anything. It was just the right kind of music.
The first time I ever encountered Wino was in the early 80s. I just got off work at Haagen-Dazs, closed the store, walked out. I had no hair. This is back in the days where, like, if you had no hair and someone had long hair, it meant friction. So anyway, I see this, like, tough-looking long-haired guy across the street, and I gotta go across the street, too. I'm like, oh, well, here comes some kind of confrontation, you know? So I go across the street, and I'm trying to walk by this guy, and he just goes like, hey! I'm like, no, here we go. And I look over, I go, yeah. And he's looking at these buttons I have on my jacket. And I think I had like a Motorhead button on my jacket, and so did he. He went, hey, Motorhead. And I went, all right, yeah, cool. Ace of Spades, all right, you know, don't kill me. And then I think he saw a button I had from a band I was in. He's like, hey, I hand painted it. And he went, oh man, those guys are cool. I said, I am those guys, you know, I'm in that band. He went, oh, cool. So we made friends. He said, I'm in the Obsessed, man. Be looking for us. I said, okay, man.
I remember in the early days, like, there was, like, the punk rock scene in Washington. There was this band called the Bad Brains that we all worshipped, right? And they were like the punk band. And one night, the Bad Brains played this band called the Obsessed, which, to our punk aesthetic, sounded a lot like a dumb heavy metal band. What struck me was, like, this huge crowd of followers that they had. And they had all these kids who were, like, just down with the Obsessed. It was really a lot of friction. And actually, for a number of shows after that, we would get into fights with these kids or kind of run into some problems with each other. But then one day I remember talking to Wino, ran into him, and we were just talking, and he said, you know, I fucking love The Faith. And The Faith were, like, this really great punk band from Washington. And it suddenly occurred to me that this guy was kind of just, like, just another kid, like, from the area, but, like, so, and he was just, we were all sort of like in the, I don't know, we just got into talking, and he was really a big fan of all the punk bands.
I remember Ian, I was in Black Flag, and Ian from Fugazi would be telling me stories like, yeah, I saw the Obsessed, and man, that guy, Scott Wino, man, he, you know, punched out this guy, and some guy was picking on some punk rocker, and he beat him up, and he's like hanging out with all of us, and he's this cool guy, but he's like really intense.
Saw the Obsessed. I think they played with the Dead Boys, but the crowd was giving them a lot of shit. Part of the crowd, though, it turned out, I found out later, like, really kind of dug them. And they did, because they were this weird, like, sort of metal band, but they were doing covers of, like, the Saints and Dead Boys and New York Dolls. And then I saw them at this club, Beneath It All, and really, really tiny, I mean, half-foot stage or something. And then I was really, like, they're in my face, and I just thought, like, this guy, like, eats people's intestines or something, man. I just thought he was, like, the fucking most scary motherfucker.
But then that's your living dream. Hold on. Nothing matters to you anyway.
obsessed when they first started playing around and in the punk scene in DC. A lot of the kids didn't really like them too much because they thought they were like too metal for the, you know, for the stuff they were into, you know, because you know how scenes are, they're really close-minded and cliquish and stuff. And I could relate to it because our band, we were from the suburbs and we had a hard time gaining acceptance within the punk scene that we were, because that's the scene we related to. And I think guys in the Obsessed kind of did too, because it was original music and, you know, original feelings, and that's what they were doing too, even though their music was slightly different.
They were probably one of the only bands doing like a real kind of slower Sabbath type of thing back when it was very, very uncool. I know that, you know, our band is kind of similar to those guys, and we definitely were not liked by people, you know, around 84.
I think the first time I saw him was like in 84 at some cafeteria on Connecticut Avenue, and I was just like, I couldn't believe that a band was that good, was that dissed and unrecognized in their own hometown. I was totally blown away.
The only one that refused to play the haircut game. He would not do it. He would, I mean, and you're talking about a sea of bald heads yelling, haircut, haircut. No, he wouldn't do it. And somehow he like still won the hearts of all the bald people, because, you know, even though they would stand there and, you know, yell haircut, 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 they were there, you know. They weren't going to miss a second of that show.
I remember driving with Tesco up to this wedding in Detroit. A friend of ours was getting married, and we just listened to this tape. We're just working each other into a frenzy about, like, we gotta do something for these guys, you know, because they're just spinning their wheels, and people gotta know about them. You know, someone's gotta be their manager, someone's gotta put their records out. But I remember thinking, there's no way I want to get involved with them on a business level, because I can just tell they're just major, like, guys, just major fuck-ups, you know.
Your whole life believing in something. Even if one person, only one person comes up to me and says, it changed my life, and it's worth it. From the corners where it starts, torn in half like a dollar off the air.
Happy mourners with no heart, it's beat of steel. I always hope Wino would get the Obsessed together and get real records out and everything, because the guy's talent is undeniable. I mean, his charisma is total. He's a great songwriter. He probably doesn't even know how good he is on guitar.
For me, Wino's music has always been so serious, and it's like the fucked up thing about it is that's the only thing he knows, for what it seems like to me. You know, he's gonna do that whether or not he makes $1 million or $10. And to me, that's what always made Wino the quintessential lifer. You know, it's just what he does. And his music's so goddamn heavy, and he means it. And you look at him, you meet him for 5 minutes, you know, he's very serious about what he's doing.
He came over to me and Griff and asked us if we wanted to dab some speed. And he goes, oh yeah, right. And he took us over to their van, and he pulled out this big blade, this big like knife about this big. And he said, okay, if you want some speed, you're gonna have to do it my way. And we're like, oh, okay. And he goes, he put like a, put a bit of speed on the end of this knife right on the point, on the sharp, on the edge of the blade, and he said, you've got to put it under your tongue and lick it off. And he was just standing there staring at us, staring us right in the face with this like massive blade about this big with a bit of speed on the top, and we're just like like this, and just fucking just scarpered basically. It's totally intimidating.
We'd like do acid or whatever kind of drugs and just like constantly listen to the Obsessed, and then it burned in my brain, and not till years later I finally met, you know, this legendary Wino, and, you know, he actually sang with my band a song while I was playing guitar, you know, and I was like, this is like, I was totally, you know, infatuated by the dude, you know, it's just like so heavy. Heaviest motherfucker I ever met.
Heathen elite, you know. Hell's Angels are trying to impress Wino.
I always did think, you know, that, you know, he would be really an amazing person if he could, like, get around society and make it in the entertainment field, you know. It would be, like, you know, a way that other people could accept people like him without wanting to, like, you know, burn them with crosses or shoot them down like dogs on the spot.
This obsessed patch, there's only a few of them left. Wino took a buck knife one night, cut it off his vest, and gave it to me on my 18th birthday.
When you think of him, he's maybe 7 or 8 feet tall. But he's actually not that tall. It's just the guy carries that much weight, you know? He's a legend.
Smooth conviction, danger blind, a twisted night.
It was a great band, now it's an excellent band because I'm playing in it.
It was late November 1989. And Ball were on what would to turn out to be the last tour ever for Ball. We were somewhere in Germany, woke up one morning, and our bass player, Kramer, had left. But luckily, the night before, we had met Guy when we were doing our show in Amsterdam, and had, like, we kind of knew something was up, and we said, we may call you. If you get the call, you gotta drop everything. So the next day, Kramer's gone, we call Guy up, meet us at the train station, and he does. So, like, you know, we spent about half an hour showing him the songs on the way. Got to Hamburg, and, you know, there he was, Guy. And he started off, he actually learned the songs great, and then as the shows went on, he seemed to forget how to play them, because he got into this thing where he became a wild man. He was like, he kept hugging his amp, like with the bass in between, getting this feedback going. And like the first show, he didn't do it till the last song or so, but every night he kept doing it like earlier and earlier. So by like the last week of the tour, you know, one or two songs into the set, and Guy was like picking up chairs, tossing them into the audience. But, you know, he came in the clutch for us when we needed a bass player. He was there, he finished out Ball for us. That was the end of Ball, and you know, you can credit Guy for that.
Guy, I've known him for a long time too, and he's always helped us out a lot when we were in Europe and organizing shows and helping us out on the road, places to stay.
He even played bass for Scream on the last half of one of the last Scream tours.
Yeah, we played
in France and Spain.
He's a great bass player to watch play because he just like goes for it.
Like some rumor that you're obsessed with back, I mean that you're obsessed with touring Europe. And I called their label, and indeed they were touring Europe. So I just decided I had some money, so I decided to follow them, you know, for 5 shows or something. And I ended up being the roadie, you know, voluntarily, humping the shit every night. And yeah, we became good friends. I mean, Greg and Wino and Scotty became good friends. And then after a while, Scotty left the band. Greg called me and asked me to join. I said, of course.
And we asked him to join the Obsessed. He flew out from Holland in 1 week, had his own money, his own equipment, and doing his song. We showed him the new ones, and we were playing the gig in less than a month. He is the man.
The first time I met any member of the current lineup of the Obsessed was in Holland in 1984. I did the graduate high school post-drift European kind of thing, and I met Guy. And I stayed with Guy for a while in Amsterdam, where he was residing at that time. And he was one of the first people that really encouraged me to play and sat down with me and showed me a bunch of stuff to play instead of just me kind of sitting alone, figuring out on my own. And for that, I am truly ever indebted to the freak.
There's a pope in the world, you might be damned. Holding all of his ill-got goods with Uncle Sam.
I first joined the band when
this bass player I played in this other band with. I was a band called
Acid Clown that never got anywhere.
He started hanging out with Wino, and I'd already gone split back to Tennessee from Los Angeles because I was pretty tired of everything. Anyway, Hellhound put out the Obsessed record, that first one, and they needed the drummer to do it, and Danny said he could call me and get me to come out here. It was a choice between cooking food for other people or playing drums.
He just bashes the shit out of his drums. It's like, he doesn't even really need a mic. He just reaches back and just fucking, he just nails the cymbals, and you can just see just sticks breaking.
Just stumbled into this club one night called the Doghouse in DC, just on my own, just kind of hanging out. And there's this guy back behind the kid. The band that was playing was a band called Acid Clown. I remember that I was just standing there watching the drummer going, this guy looks kind of familiar. Wood was just flying by my head, you know. The drumsticks, shavings were just flying by my head, you know. That was Greg. Greg is the rock, you know. Greg is the pillar.
My experience with them is more of a sensitive nature and even educational in the particular case of their drummer, who's not just a friend, but is also my Spanish tutor. And I'd like to share with you a phrase that he's taught me in Spanish, which is Los pelos de mi culo son tus pestañas, which means your eyelashes look like the hairs of my butt, which I use constantly.
Little grass on the comfort side, your easy choice. I'm leaning fast to the twisted knife, warm boys.
I don't really think of the Obsessed as a crossover band so much as I don't think the Obsessed is anything except the Obsessed. They like occupy their own space in the musical world, because no one does what they do. No one does what Wino does. It's just his thing, you know, straight up. No one else can match it for me. And I hear other bands that have sort of similar styles, or other bands that kind of profess to be really, like, you know, kind of have this real hard edge or real kind of heavy vibe to whatever, but it always just smacks of sort of falseness. And in fact, like, Wino's one of the few people I know that I feel like the guy is just 100%, he's like the real thing.
Actually getting a chance to see the Obsessed play, I had a little demo tape, I had both their records and all that kind of shit, and I wasn't quite sure what to expect. And they come on stage, you know, no intro, nothing, just walk on stage, Lionel Craig says fucking Sun Amps on 10, and starts feeding back, and all of a sudden, basically 30 minutes later, it was over with, and I'm standing there, plastered against the back of the fucking little club there, and the drummer's hands were just covered in blood. He was beating them on the snares. He was using a rented drum kit. They didn't even give a shit. They just played their asses off. You know, didn't even say anything to the crowd, just played and left. It was like some kind of, you know, schmooze show or something. And they just destroyed. You know, and all three of those guys, just killer musicians, they just go right in, dig on it, and go.
Obsessed music is basically the hard rock, and that's my favorite genre. That's the genre that influences me the most. That's the genre that I put on in my stereo when I need to vacuum my house and be motivated, is the Obsessed. I put the Obsessed on to vacuum.
I remember we went to DC, and there were all these kids there who traded Obsessed demos and Obsessed tapes. And everybody was really into it. And I took one home and I listened to it, and it was, you know, the shit. There was something really cool about it, and it was in that really good, like, you know, messed up, heavy 70s style. They're probably my favorite band that do heavy style of music, because it's not derivative at all. When you see them, there's really something going on that's really original and really easy to get into, and they're heavy as hell.
What is
metal, okay? What is a metal band supposed to do, and what is a metal band supposed to portray? Now, there's one aspect where the metal thing is where they say, well, it's straight out of a comic book, and we should make it, you know, the ultimate in metal is Kiss, or Motley Crue, or Iron Maiden, where they just bring things to excess, where Obsessed was a kind of a, with the opposite. How little could we do to portray this image of metal?
The tempo of the band was the thing that really set them way ahead. And so many bands, you know, the heavy metal punk rock thing, we just don't realize how much more punches you can get in if you just slow it down a little bit, man.
Obsessed, to me, was a subtle thing. Now, if I'm gonna go off on Wino, all I can say is, once you're turned on to something, either you're gonna let it soak in or reject it.
I think he's an amazing guitar player. He plays the kind of guitar I really like drinking Clorox all night long guitar. Like I smoke angel dust and wound people guitar. I mean, the guy's guitar playing sounds like trouble, not the band, just the situation.
There he goes. He draws up again. Oh, that was Brother Moose here. Hey, it ain't it. For a second, is there a Mad Dog thing? I think we got something to choose from.
How does he fucking do that? I mean, how many hours a day did he practice to learn how to solo like that? Or did he come out of the womb like that? Did he come out of the lunar womb with a Strat soloing?
If I locked myself in a shed for 10 years, I still wouldn't be able to play a guitar like Scott Weiner did.
The Obsessed were very influential in the early days with the L7, when we always felt that LA really sucked, and there was a market and places to play in Europe, because we'd always hear stories about the Obsessed going to Europe and being very successful. And then they'd come home to LA and play to four or five people, which is our story as well. So they really sort of opened up this trail in Europe that we sort of followed through on.
At the bottom's where it ends, no between. That's life's riddles, fate's wins, and depravity.
Joe and I, when we first met, we first started talking, that was really the basis of our first conversation, was just what an epic, important, incredible band the Obsessed were, and just how much we loved them. Yeah, we worshiped them, you know. And when we first started playing, we were just like, well, let's see if we can write a bunch of songs like the Obsessed or something.
When it's authentic, and when it's a feel that can't be denied, then I'd say, Wino, you know? What a fucking guitar player, number one. And he's one of my favorite singers. Nothing much to prove, just soul-felt vocals. And if anyone could ask for more than that, then I'm not that particular person.
So low, it's been real, a total feat. By his hand, a lonely man, looking for a street sign.
We were playing the demo in the car one day, and Ian said, you know, the Obsessed have the sound of a man getting angry very slowly. And you're like, whoa, yeah. And like, it's once you get a man who's slow to anger, angry, he stays angry a long time.
Almost magical kind of music. It's like, there's so much honesty and natural heaviness that comes out of that guy. It's kind of amazing, really. Not much else I can say.
This is an Obsessed t-shirt that Dave put together. And it's a rare piece, and we think it's sweet. And you know who this is. I mean, that is Juana's veins right there. And that's his hair. That's a shirt right there. Back then, I was heavily into, like, dreaming, you know? And I showed him some of my dreams sometimes, you know? So he decided to write songs about it, you know? Like, he said, Eric, I wrote some songs about you. I said, oh, no, man. You know, I got a picture of Scott when he was younger, man. You want to see it?
I'd love to see it. That's what we think. It's pretty close.
Christ.